Dale. Bueno, empezamos a grabar ahora.
Sí.
¿Eso? Dale, empiezo a grabar. Espérame, ¿eh? Bueno, pongo grabar en la nube o en esta computadora. ¿En dónde estás grabando? ¿En la computadora o en la nube?
La computadora, Fede, dale.
Bueno, yo grabo en la nube.
Que no se pierda.
Ya está,
Decir que
Marina.
haya varios
Bueno,
backups.
okay, so good morning in this second day of the conference of quantum foundations. So we have today the pleasure of the first talk by Omar Osenda, who is from Universidad Nacional de Córdoba in Argentina. He will speak about the use of optimization methods for quantum mechanics problems. So go on, please, Omar.
Okay, thank you, Mariela. Well, congratulations to all the organizers for, finally, that the 10th edition of this conference finally has, is taking place. And thank you for the opportunity to address the, some colleagues in these times. Actually, I usually prepare too much material for the talk, so I have planned this talk in two parts. I don't know how I will use exactly the time, but depending on how much time and how fast I can go, I will cover the transmission of quantum states and maybe something of about a few body problems, but mainly the talk is about the transmission of quantum states. Usually, when this work is not published yet, you can find it in the archive. But it's an ongoing collaboration with Pablo Serra and Alejandro Ferrón. And well, we can start thinking what is exactly a quantum state transfer, what we can think a quantum channel is made of. 15 years ago, talking about a change of quantum systems, replicas of quantum systems that are interacting between them and, well, that can be used as a wire to transmit information. Well, 15 years ago, this was mainly a dream. It was the realm of theoretical physics. Today, there are a lot of technical advances that made the transmission of quantum state possible. In solid state implementation, that is the setting that many people think about. In quantum state implementations, for example, the wire that will transmit the quantum state could be, for example, a chain of quantum dots or a chain of superconducting qubits, etc. Ideally, the wire is used to transmit quantum information from a sender to a receiver. Okay, the sender ideally will prepare some quantum state that is the information that want to send. The channel should be initialized to a simple state, and the receiver will perform some measurements to retrieve the information that the sender sent to him. Okay, so obviously this is a quite complicated problem if the Hamiltonian of the system is a many-body Hamiltonian, and the interactions are well long-ranged, etc. So most people think usually in very simple systems, in particular, many times the problem is not solved in the whole Hilbert space. So usually the Hamiltonian has some symmetries, some that allow to restrict the dynamic of the problem to a reduced Hilbert space, to a subspace, a subspace of the whole Hilbert space. There are many protocols. A protocol is a recipe to prepare the state, the how the system evolves in time, and finally how the information is retrieved at the other extreme of the chain. Okay, so many people is familiarized with the XX Hamiltonian, that is a spin Hamiltonian that has only interaction, for example, in the plane, is an anisotropic Hamiltonian. And to fix idea, many people think that the initial state is prepared in the first side of the channel. The rest of the chain is initialized in a zero state that, depending on the the physics of the problem, is maybe the the ground state of the system. And the time evolution obviously is produced for some with some unitary time evolution operator, okay? Because at least in principle, the simplest way to analyze these problems is using unitary time evolution. Obviously, it is possible to consider an open chain, an open quantum system, but the problem becomes almost intractable. At least if the length of the chain will be around the tens of spins or things like that. Well, this is just to fix ideas. There are many forms, many protocols, but this is the simplest. An initial state, and in the simplest protocol, the time evolution is given by the autonomous Hamiltonian of the chain. There is not external forces, so the time evolution is the simplest time evolution operator, is the exponential of the Hamiltonian. Okay, it is possible to use the spectral decomposition of the operator. A lot of things are easy to calculate. Even more, if this is the initial state and the Hamiltonian is ferromagnetic and the zero state is the ground state, this Hamiltonian commutes with the total magnetization, so the dynamics keeps is restricted to the one excitation subspace. So the dimension of the actual Hilbert space is basically the size of the chain. If the chain has n spins, then the dimension of the Hilbert space in the one excitation subspace, the dimension of the Hilbert space, the subspace is just n. So okay, many times the quantity that is used to quantify how good, how successful is the protocol is called the fidelity, the transmission fidelity, that can be calculated rather easily with using the amplitude probability that the that an excitation is transferred from the first side of the chain to the last side of the chain. This quantity is quite easy to calculate in the sense that it's just an expectation value of the time evolution operator, okay? This particular formula can be deduced because to qualify the channel, usually what is used is an average over the whole initial state, over all the initial state that can be prepared, okay? Just to fix some ideas, many times the well, it is interesting to consider that the chain could be in a disorder state. The couplings maybe cannot be fixed to some desired value. Maybe there are defects in the fabrication process, or just like every nanostructural system, it is quite difficult to fix all the couplings, etc. And this is, for example, how it is possible, for example, to control the time evolution of the problem. Sometimes it is useful just to consider that the transmission process is forced or controlled by applying some external control functions. Why? Because many times the natural time evolution, the autonomous time evolution, is not sufficient to achieve the a good transmission. Obviously, the idea is that if the fidelity reaches the unity, well, the transmission is perfect. All values of FT superior to 0.999 are considered interesting, but obviously, depending on the Hamiltonian, how this exchange coupling coefficients are chosen, etc., this fidelity could be a fiber that is rather lower than the unit. So it is useful sometimes to consider a force evolution. But the problem of the force evolution is obviously controlling a nanoscopic, a microscopic quantum system is quite difficult. Many times it is impossible to control the system with smooth functions. There are a lot of considerations that can be made advising against using a control evolution. Many times it's the only option because the interactions cannot be chosen, but are fixed for some fundamental interaction. But the force or the control evolution of a quantum system is quite difficult. In particular, if the system doesn't have a lot of symmetries, or the dynamics cannot be kept in a subspace, it is quite difficult to calculate this this control evolution, because obviously the control functions shall be obtained using an optimization method. Okay, so anyway, for the XX Hamiltonian, the people has been working in this area for many years. So there is a lot of interesting results, like perfect quantum state transmission is achievable choosing particular values for the quantities ji for these quantities, choosing some very particular values, it is possible to achieve using autonomous time evolution. It is possible to achieve perfect quantum state transmission, basically for any initial state. Even more, it can be proved that the dynamics behaves like a inversion, a specular inversion in the quantum chain. So the thing that you prepare in a half of the chain, it will be reflected at some time in the other half of the chain. It's a very interesting. There are regimes where almost perfect quantum state transmission can be achieved just choosing or just using an almost homogeneous quantum state. All the coefficients, all the strange coefficients are equal, except a pair or maybe four coupling, exchange coupling coefficients could be chosen different, and a very, very good quantum state transmission can be achieved. Okay, so why the XXX Hamiltonian was studied so intensively? Why there are so many results? Basically, because this fundamental fact, it's quite easy to go in the X Hamiltonian from a given, I can choose the couplings and, well, I can calculate it is possible to calculate the spectrum of the system, or it is possible to prescribe the spectrum that I want to have for some Hamiltonian, and there is a unique way to calculate the exchange coupling distribution, all the exchange coupling distribution. In this case, at least in the case where we are dealing with the one excitation subspace, is a one-to-one relationship. Okay, I can prescribe, for example, a very simple spectrum. For example, I can choose that the spectrum of the system consists in n eigenvalues that can be chosen. They are equispaces between them. Okay, that sounds like a system that is quite possible to that the all contribution from the eigenvalues can add constructively at some time. So I can choose this spectrum, and the coefficients can be calculated one by one in a unique way. Obviously, most quantum spin chains doesn't have this property. In particular, the Heisenberg Hamiltonian doesn't have this property. It is impossible to prescribe a spectrum, and in that way obtain the coefficients that produce that spectrum. Okay. If as anybody that has found sometimes the Bethe ansatz, the relationship between the spectrum in the Heisenberg Hamiltonian is really obscure. Or more precisely, because of this, many words focus in the control transmission in the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, because a lot of people thought that it was easier to control the a quantum chain, an homogeneous quantum chain obeying the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, and controlling, designing very sophisticated control pulses, can be found that maybe the transmission time, the transmission, the time in which the receiver can retrieve the information sent by the sender, well, that time is around, obviously, if J is equal to one, there are almost no energy units, no. So it is natural to measure the transmission time in units of the length of the chain. That is the only characteristic length. Okay, if J is exactly equal to one, this is a very good unit to measure the time. I didn't say it, but another interesting quantity or another interesting feature of the change with the XX Hamiltonian is that here it is rather easy to show that the transmission time, the time that the receiver should wait to measure and obtain a very good fidelity of transmission, that time is bounded by the time that is consistent with the quantum speed limit. So it is rather easy to think that this Hamiltonian has a sound velocity for the spin waves, and that velocity is related to the quantum speed limit. In the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, there is no simple way to assess which is the time scale in which convenient to measure or to try to produce a very good transmission. Okay, so what can be done with all this? Well, actually, we said that that this quantity, the probability that an excitation can be transmitted from the first side to the last side, is a quantity that depends on the spectrum and on the some coefficients of the eigenvalue, of the eigenvector. So this quantity can be optimized. Okay, I can think that this is a complicated function that depends, obviously, on all the exchange coefficients that determine the Hamiltonian. So maybe I can choose somehow the exchange couplings, and using that exchange coupling, I can calculate the spectrum, the eigenvalues, and calculate this. So if I can devise a method to explore a large number of values of the J coefficients, maybe I can find the largest value for this quantity for some time that I can choose somehow. Okay, so it is obvious that this function, the amplitude of probability that an excitation goes from the first side to the last side, is a quantity that depends on all the coefficients. In a general change, there will be n J coefficients, n exchange coefficients. So for a chain, for example, of 50 spins, it is a rather large space, parameter space, to explore. So it is hopeless to try to investigate the whole whole space in a completely random way, a space of 50 dimensions is too big to explore. So maybe the exploration can be done using some kind of random walk, but it must be a directed random walk in the parameter space. Okay. Well, fortunately, there are a lot of I don't know if many, but the people in the statistical mechanics area has devised a lot of methods to explore a rather large parameter space, and one of these methods are the pivot methods that are used for global optimization. So pivot methods are basically a good way to generate a random walk that explores in an intelligent way a given parameter space. Obviously, this is an example, an abstract example of a search conducted over a two-dimensional parameter space. This is a typical chart flow that can be found in all the papers in pivot methods are paper from the 90s. So instead of using some colorful cartoons, it's most common to find chart flows like this, because chart flow were the way to express an algorithm. Okay, I don't want to enter, but I mean any pivot method, any method can be used to search, that is useful to search in a large parameter space. It can be used to perform exactly the same that we did. So, for example,
excuse me, you have 10 more minutes, so yep. To finish everything.
Thank you. This is, for example, how can a search for the coefficients can be done. This is a short chain, but is useful because the chains that are used are termed centrosymmetric, because there are symmetry between the first exchange coefficient and the last, and the optimization method proceeds, the pivot method proceeds like by looking in a particular hypercube that contains all the possible values of the exchange coefficients. The problem with the Heisenberg, Hamiltonian, is there is not, and believe me, there is not a simple way to bound the values that of the exchange coefficient that I need to use to achieve the transmission for some time, because again the spectrum is quite complicated. we proceeded by looking at the best possible values of J that provided a very good the best fidelity of transmission in a small hypercube, but then we proceed to enlarge the hypercube, and we go from some exchange coupling distributions that are obtained using some particular transmission time, and this is what we found after a lot of numerical effort, that effectively we can found a very good near perfect quantum state transmission for spin chains of basically the length that we wanted, and for the arrival times that of our choosing. Okay, so the pivot method is able to find the necessary exchange couplings to produce very good or near perfect quantum state transmission in the Heisenberg Hamiltonian. That is a result that was not known previously, but obviously it is the way to look for this exchange coupling is clearly is the result of a random walk that is performed. It's a direct random walk, but maybe we can think that well, the probability of transmission is quite high, it's quite interesting. If you look at in this inset, all the transmission probabilities can be made, well, basically are bigger than 0.999 if we want to that kind, that quality of transmission. But obviously, once we get the exchange coupling distribution, we wanted to understand if the solutions, this solution has some physics in them, or are just results that the only thing that can be said about that about them is that they provide a very good quantum state transmission. So we looked for the probability of having a good transmission. This is a typical time evolution near the transmission time. These are the peaks of the probability for different settings. We can design or use different time, different arrival times. So, for example, these are very short arrival times. The black curves, the red curves correspond to a larger arrival time. The blue one, a more larger arrival time. But each one of these was calculated with a different exchange coupling distribution. But well, some of us have a strong background in scaling and that kind of property. So we scale the time evolution of the probability, and we found that basically it doesn't matter what is the time, the arrival time. Basically, the time behavior around the arrival time is basically the same, which is a quite neat result, because the exchange coefficients that are used to calculate the probability of the arrival probability for a given time has nothing to do with the another exchange coupling distribution. So, for example, it's possible to after some numerical experiments are done, it is possible to study what is the minimum size of the aperture necessary to find where this exchange coupling can be found. This is that size. For example, we can say that if we choose larger arrival times, the strength of the exchange coupling distribution, the maximum value of the exchange coupling distribution, basically decays in an exponential way. So in a sense, we can say that for very large for very large arrival time, basically the chain will be, well, basically almost homogeneous, but not exactly homogeneous. There is no need to have very different values between the exchange coupling distributions. Another way to qualify how good are these exchange coupling distributions, for example, consider once the exchange coupling, the set of exchange couplings have been obtained, what about adding some disorder if, looking at this, fiber, is quite obvious that the probability, the probability that is related to fidelity can be made as large as close to the unity as wanted, but these values are stable. If some disorder is produced, everything maybe the transmission under some disorder is completely destroyed or not. Well, we consider some static disorder applied to the chain, and we found that the chain was able to sustain some disorder. So the in some sense the maximum found for found by the pivot method is rated well, because applying some disorder can be thought like making another stochastic search, stochastic search around the values that the pivot method found. But basically, we can say that the spin distribution are produce a very good, very, very, very good transmission, and that they are quite stable against disorder. So as I said, I prepared a lot of material, but the conclusion of this
part. We are almost in time.
Yeah. The conclusion, well, the physics near this new configuration, this new change, is quite explored. We want to study the physics, how the transmission is produced in this change that have the couplings tailored specifically to produce a large fidelity of transmission. As a stochastic search, everything worked fine, but we don't know why. At least, well, in that moment when we wrote the manuscript, we didn't have clues why everything works so fine. I think that we now have some clues and we are exploring them. This procedure will be exitously successfully translated to another Hamiltonians. We are looking for that. There are another procedures to determine these couplings in another way. Maybe there are looking at the exchange couplings that are calculated, it is not obvious that they can be translated in a simple formula. We're discussing also if some experimental implementation can be made. Well, and that's it. Half minutes.
Okay.
1 minute and half larger than that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Omar. So if someone has just a short question, we can put it here. you said, mean the number of elements in mind. You studied the length of the chain. You did a search. Sorry, you search with the length of the chain depending on n.
Sorry, the communication was interrupted, but I couldn't hear the question. Can you repeat? Sorry, Mariela.
If you did a search with the length of the chain, with depending on the number n. You showed some here, but you mean small, the size of the system you
No, we can study the chains from 10 spins to 100. There is not an actual limit. We stopped in 100 because we didn't want to wait for the results, but there is not a practical limit. A chain of 100 sites is clearly beyond any practical implementation, at least for mm-hmm. a few next years.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But there is no an upper bound. Mm-hmm. We stop around 100, but for some new experiments or for some new results, we are maybe looking at 120. Yeah.
Okay. So we don't have any comments. So we thank again Omar with a virtual clap.
Well,
so we can change the speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, organizers. I want to thank you again. Congratulations to achieve the 10th conference. Yeah. And well, for a very good acronym.
Thank you.
It's quite X-Files. Bye.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
So now we have Fabrizio Toscano. We can change. If you stop sharing screen.
I need the authorization to share my screen. Now
first, Omar share.
It is supposed that everyone can share the screen.
Do you see?
I'm not the host of the Zoom session, so
we can see your screen, Fabrizio.
Okay. So I can start.
Mariela, are you there?
Well, I assume that I can start.
Yes.
So thank you for the invitation. It is a pleasure to be here. I have been presenting my works in this series of conference since 2017, I think, and it is a pleasure to continue to present our work in here. So first I want to present my collaborators that are part of the organizers in this conference, Professor Gustavo Martín Bosic and Mariela Portesi that are from University of La Plata, and Steve Saussure, that is from France. And you can see our work that starts, this collaboration started in the first conference that attend in this series. And well, it's in the archive, and this is the work. So I want to take the title of this conference that said that 10 irreversible years on quantum foundation in Argentina. I want to give you a brief motivation of our work that is based on quantum, quantum irreversible thermodynamics. In quantum irreversible thermodynamics, the main goal that the people want to achieve is how to describe in an arbitrary open quantum evolution the rate of change of the von Neumann entropy. And based on in thermodynamics way of thinking, this rate of change is splitting in two parts. One is the rate of change of the entropy production, and the other is the rate of change of the entropy flux. The second law of thermodynamics is just the statement that the first part, that is the rate of change of entropy production, is always positive or zero. Okay. There is a big open question, which is the general way to do this splitting in a general open quantum evolution. But the problem is solved in several cases. This type of analysis gives a clue of how to analyze the stationary situation, equilibrium situations in open quantum evolutions. For example, the stationary situation is the balance between these two terms here. When the balance occurs, but also each of these terms is zero, this corresponds to thermal equilibrium, okay? But I want to present here an alternative way to, at least in a particular kind of open quantum evolution, but very important kind. I will present another splitting of the rate of change of the von Neumann entropy that is associated with the notions of fluctuation and dissipation. And this new splitting allows to analyze the stationary situations in a different way, okay? So this is the main motivation of our work. So first I will introduce which is the notion of fluctuation and dissipation in classical Markov processes. I will talk about the additive noisy Gaussian channel and how to generalize this very important channel in a classical information theory to a more general channel that are the general Gaussian channels. And then I will start to talk about quantum open quantum dynamics and how to describe memoryless quantum communication channels that are continuous in time. And I will show that all these kind of memoryless quantum channels continuous in time are described by a one-parameter quantum dynamical semigroups. Then I will present the main result of our work, that is a new decomposition of the infinitesimal generator, non-unitary infinitesimal generator associated with this one-parameter quantum dynamical semigroups that verifies a Lindblad type of master equation. Then I will show how this decomposition of the infinitesimal generator allows to write the rate of change of the Bornemann entropy in a particular way, where you can identify the fluctuation and dissipation terms. And this is the quantum analog of the classical, very well known Debreuchian identity that appears here in classical Markov process. Then I will compare our approach with the approach of the thermodynamic irreversible quantum thermodynamics. And I will give an example in one parameter general quantum Gaussian channels. Let's start with a noisy fluctuation classical information theory. The most important type of channel here is the additive noise Gaussian channel that corresponds, appears in very natural random processes that are viewed as a large sum of noises, sources of noises. And if you combine this with the central limit theorem, you end up with this type of channels. So the channel is you have a random variable and you combine with a noise that is described by a normal distribution random variable. And this square root of t is the strength of this noise, okay? So the probability distribution of the random variable at the output of the channel verifies the very well-known heat equation, okay? So the quantification of the fluctuation or noise in this channel is given by the original, the classical Debreuian identity that was proved for by Stamp in 1959, and is the rate of change of the Shannon entropy here. Okay. And this rate of change is proportional to the Fisher information. This Fisher information is the so-called Fisher information associated with displacement, where you can this displacement depends like any Fisher information by a parameter theta, but this parameter because it's a displacement disappears, and this type of Fisher information is also known as unparameter Fisher information. Okay, and this quantity is always positive, so this classical Debreuian identity only says that the quantify the fact that this random variable becomes more random as time increases. Okay, so the generalization of this type of channels in classical information theory is given by the so-called Fokker-Planck channels that correspond to multidimensional channels that are modeled by Langevin forces that are described by stochastic differential equations. And the more important type of these channels are the so-called general Gaussian classical channels that correspond to Einstein Uhlenbeck processes. These processes are described by this stochastic equation. The first term is the drift vector. Okay. Here, this x is a vector, that is the multidimensional random variables. And the second term of the differential equation is the standard binary process that is characterized by this matrix here that is known as the matrix of Langevin forces. The probability distribution or associated with this vector of random variables verifies a linear Fokker-Planck equation here is the linear programming equation. Where the first term is the drift term, and the second one is the diffusion term that is characterized by this matrix D that is written in this way with this matrix of Langevin forces, okay? In the case, for example, when this random variable X is just a phase space variable in a classical mechanical system, the typical example of in this case is the description of their classical Brownian motion that is given by this Fokker-Klein equation with these phase space variables. And the quantification of fluctuation and dissipation associated with this Fokker-Prime equation is given by this generalized classical De Bruijn identity that was first written with this type of approach, information theoretical approach in 2017 by with Bisono, Shock, and Log. And this De Bruijn identity, the first term is the contribution of the fluctuation. Here appears the diffusion matrix. And this diffusion, and also the matrix of fission information. And the second term is the contribution of dissipation. The first term is always positive, could not be zero, and the second term could be positive, negative, or null, okay? In the case where you don't have a drift matrix in one dimension, you recover the additive Gaussian noise that we already seen, okay? So let's take a deep look at this structure of the generalized classical De Bruijn identity, okay? So the diffusion matrix is written in terms of this matrix of Langevin forces. And because this matrix is semi-definite positive, you can write in this way, using the columns of the matrix of Langevin forces. Of course, this decomposition is not unique. You can use any Langevin forces that are all described in this way. And if the columns of the matrix sigma here is less than the dimension of the random system, then the Langevin forces are linearly independent. And if you have more columns, the Langevin forces are not linearly independent. But all this, if you fix D, you can choose any description in terms of Langevin forces that for a given D, okay? So using this decomposition here, it is easy to see that this trace of these matrices here can be written in terms of the classical fission information associated with the displacement probability distribution. And the displacement is given by these Langevin forces, okay? For the second term, that is the drift matrix here, you have, you can decompose this drift term here as two type of forces. One is the antisymmetric part of this matrix that correspond to conservative forces, and the symmetric part that to non-conservative forces. And it is easy to see that the conservative forces don't give any contribution here, and because are antisymmetric. And this trace here is just the average flux of the dissipative force that gives the total amount of change of the probability distribution in the direction of minus the dissipative force. Okay. So here you have, for example, a good explanation of how the stationary situation occurs, because in the stationary situation, this contribution of the fluctuation must counterbalance this average flux of the dissipative force. So let's now we want to apply these ideas that appears in classical Markov processes in Fokker-Planck channels in classical information theory in the quantum domain. So let's start talking about, in general, what is a quantum channel, a quantum communication channel. It's just a map, input-output map, that correspond to quantum mechanical operations. This operation in the Schrödinger picture correspond to maps that are completely positive and trace-preserving that act on density matrix here and are trace-preserving. In the Hasseme picture, this map can be described by a superoperator that preserves the identity. So in the Hasseme picture, the preservation of the density of the trace of the density matrix in the Hasseme picture correspond to the preservation of the identity. Okay, this will be important. In general, quantum channels, quantum communication channels, are form semigroups. If you compose quantum channels, you have another quantum channel, and you have always a direction of time in this composition, so it forms a semigroup. Quantum channels have an inverse only when are described by a unitary evolution. Okay, so the most common situation is always you have a situation where the environment affects the evolution. So the most common situation is to have a non-unitary quantum channels, and this non-unitary quantum channels gives a degradation of information during their use. And in order to describe this degradation, you need to include some information about your implementation of the channel, and this gives the necessity to use maps that are continuous in time. Okay, and when you use this type of maps to describe the situation, the particular situation that you have, if you want to describe memoryless quantum channels, you end up with an evolution that is described always by the time-independent Markovian master equation, and whose solution are one-parameter semigroups. So let's use this type of open quantum evolution to apply our ideas. So here you have the Lindblad master equation in general, okay? And these are L are the Lindblad operators, and the solution is given by this map here that is a dissolution at least in finite dimension always produce a type of evolution known as a one parameter quantum dynamical semigroups. And this is also the case for the very important channels in continuous variable system that correspond with to linear master equation that I will show you in a minute. So the infinitesimal propagator of this Limpia equation has two parts. The first one is the infinitesimal propagation associated with the unitary evolution, and the second is the associated with the non-unitary evolution. So we answer to this question which is the general structure of the fluctuation and dissipation of one parameter quantum dynamical semigroup in general. So our answer is the following. We found that the infinitesimal generator of the non-unitary evolution can be split in this way, where appears three superoperators. Here are written these superoperators in terms of the Lindblad operators, where we use for the Lindblad operators the usual decomposition in this real and imaginary a part of the arbitrary Lindblad operators. So the first, the L1 that appear here, all these superoperators are real. It means that maps Hermitian operators in Hermitian operators. L1 is also self-adjoint with respect to the Hilbert-Schmidt scalar product, okay, and this self-adjoint operator verified this, and this means that the map that if you use only this as a infinitesimal generator, the solution that you find here is a possible quantum dynamical semigroup that is unital, okay? The other two, L2 here and L3, that combine it in this way, L2 is self-adjoint, L3 is antisymmetric, and the combination of both also gives a possible infinitesimal generator of a quantum dynamical semigroup in itself. Okay. This decomposition, it is very well known that the Lindblad operators verifies some symmetries. The first symmetry that must be verified by the Lindblad operators is this one, where you can apply any unitary matrix here to the Lindblad operators to obtain another Lindblad operators that describe the same system. Okay, under this symmetry, these decomposition are invariant. Okay, so it's not affected by this type of the other symmetry that the Lindblad operators must verify is this one, where you change the Lindblad operators in this way, and also the unitary part in this way. Okay, well, the Lindblad operators appears in this Hamiltonian here. If you apply this symmetry to our decomposition, you see that L1 and L2 are invariant, and L3 only change, but in a unitary way. This means that appears only a contribution that is unitary, okay? Associated with this Hamiltonian H line here, okay? H prime. I will show you that the first part of this decomposition is associated with the fluctuation contribution to the Gaussian dynamical semi-loop, and the other two to dissipation. So let's see this, okay? Here we have the unitary part, the non-unitary, okay? And these are our decomposition, okay? So to see how this is associated with fluctuation and dissipation, let us calculate this the rate of change of the monomer entropy that can be split in this way, where the first term is associated with this L1. So this delta T is minus the trace of the density operator that evolves here. And here you must put the self-adjoint of L1, but because it's the adjoint of L1, but because it's self-adjoint appears L1. So this term here, using this, well, the other term is you must put the other part, okay? So this the first part here can be written using this relative entropy that is written here, and the second derivative with respect to this parameter theta, when you use this type of evolution here, it is easy to see that have this structure here with respect to this double commutator that is the generator of this unitary evolution here. And you see that this type of structure appears here and appears here. So it is easy to see that the first term, it can be written in this way. And this displacement of the quantum state is can be associated with the quantum Langevin forces. This very interesting to see that this divergent basic quantum Fisher information, okay, can be related with the relative entropy in this way. So this sum of quantum Fisher information relative entropy basis measures the noise that this unit evolution associated with the Langevin forces enters in the evolution. Okay, there is a microphone that is open. If we compare this expression here with the expression that appears in the classical Gaussian channels that we found, we see a very similar structure here, okay? But also this is for the Shannon entropy, and this is for the von Neumann entropy, okay? But you have also this part here that is the measure of the noise introduced in the dynamic by the Langevin forces here, okay? This is for classical Gaussian channels, but this is for any one parameter quantum dynamical semi-loop. So this is the quantum de Bruijn identity for any quantum dynamical semi-loop, okay? This is our main result of our work. So let's compare how the equilibrium appears in our description, so we can use this quantum de Bruin identity for one parameter quantum dynamical semi-loops. And you see that the stationary situation arises when these two terms balance, because the first term is always positive, it cannot be zero, and in the stationary situation, it must balance the second one, okay? In the case of the decomposition that appears in irreversible quantum thermodynamics, it looks similar, but it's different. So this is not the same as this, and the rate of freedom of entropy production, and the second term is not this, okay? And in the problem with this description here is that, for example, for in general, the splitting, the expression that you have for this first term, for example, it depends on things of the environment. Okay, you can avoid this problem and have an expression only with ingredients from the system and not from the environment. This can be done in quantum dynamical semi-group, and this was performed by the Spohn, and the expression is this one, okay? And in this case, but this only can be done, this only can be done when the quantum dynamical semigroup has a stationary situation. But our decomposition is always true. You have this decomposition even if the quantum dynamical semigroup do not have any stationary situation. In this description, as I said, the stationary situation distinguish between the stationary situation and the equilibrium thermal situation. Okay, and we will see that in our description, this is possible también, also. So let's apply our approach to the so-called linear Lindblad master equation in continuous variable systems that are known as Gaussian dynamical semigroups. In this type of open quantum evolution, the Hamiltonian of the system is a quadratic in the canonical conjugate operators, and the Lindblad operators are linear in these canonical conjugate operators. Okay, these are
Fabricio.
Yes,
you have around 5 minutes, including the question.
Okay, so I will go quickly. So in this case, in for this type of system, the description for the Wigner function of the system is verified the same Fokker-Planck equation that the classical case, but in this case, the Wigner function could be a probability distribution or not. When the this Wigner function corresponds to Gaussian states, this is the that are probability distribution. You have the description of the same description as the classical case. In this case, these channels preserve the Gaussianity. If you start with a Gaussian state, then you end up with a Gaussian state. And in the stationary situation, if the system has a stationary situation, the stationary state is Gaussian, and all initial states end up in that. If you start with any state, you end up in this Gaussian state. So let's. I want to show the quantum de Bruijn identity that we found in this case. You correspond if you apply this. This is for any quantum dynamical semigroup, and you use the Lindblad equation, you end up with this quantum debris identity from Gaussian dynamical semigroups. And if you compare with the classical case, you see a very similar structure, okay? But here appear, for example, the matrix for the quantum diversion basis quantum information, and here appears the classical case, okay? If you start with a Gaussian state, that is, and in this quantum diversion identity, you can calculate the quantum diversion basis efficient information and gives this expression here. And if you compare this with the Shannon entropy, you see a very similar structure also. But in this case, this matrix that appear here and this matrix that appear here are connected, and you can prove this relation. So there is a relation of the quantum diversion identity and the classical diversion identity when you start with Gaussian states in quantum dynamical, Gaussian dynamical semigroups. Well, in the case, if you analyze the situation when you goes to the equilibrium, you goes to the equilibrium in a way that this difference here goes to zero. Okay, so in the equilibrium, the monomial entropy, the rate of change of the monomial entropy goes to the rate of change of the Shannon entropy, and both goes to zero. Okay. Let me show. I will. This is a way to distinguish equilibrium from a stationary situation. I don't enter in this here. I don't have time, but I want to show this last transparency that shows that our decomposition of the non-unitary infinitesimal propagator of quantum dynamical semiloop is related with the coherence. And here we have the Gaussian dynamical semigroup in continuous variable system, but I want to show a numerical simulation, but the numerical simulation is not associated with a quadratic Hamiltonian, because I use this from an old work, and this so the non-unitary part is the same as the Gaussian dynamical semigroup, but the unitary part is not quadratic, it's a non-linear evolution. And here we see the following. If you start with, for example, with a Gaussian state, that this is a coherent state, without this part here, this coherent state evolves here with a non-linear kick harmonic oscillator, okay? And you see that the Wigner function starts to shows interference pattern. And here we have the sum of the two evolution, the unitary plus the non-unitary, that corresponds to the non-unitary part of a Gaussian dynamical semigroup. And here in the at the bottom, you have the classical evolution of not a quantum evolution. And you see that are almost identical. So in this case, we use a limit where this dissipative part is zero. So we only have this diffusion part. So this shows that diffusion of this is associated with the coherence. Okay.
I'm sorry, Fabrizio, but we are on time and we need to make a break before we start the another session. So if you want to close.
No, this is, I finished.
Okay, I'm sorry for this.
Okay.
Maybe we can start the break and the connection is here. So if somebody wants to talk with you or with another person, with the people that present their talks, it is possible. But officially, we start the break now. And we'll be back 10:30, some minutes. Jorge, ¿estás ahí? Jorge, Hirsch.
Jorge, ¿estás conectado?
I am here, Fede. Bye.
Ah, Giuseppe, great, great. Do you want to try your presentation?
Yeah.
How are you doing?
Fine, fine.
Great, great. Okay.
Can you see the slide, right? Full screen.
Yes.
Okay, yes. Perfecto.
Perfect. Okay.
Jorge, are you there? Jorge Hirsch, do you want to approve the presentation?
Okay, I am ready. If you want, I can, where you want, I can start.
The next talk, okay. Empezamos ahora.
Yes,
I think so, yes.
Okay, we start with the second part of the first session this morning. The first talk is in charge of Giuseppe Sergioli from the University of Cagliari.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you to all the organizers who invited me. For me, it's very proud. I'm very proud to be invited to this 10th conference of Quantum Foundation. I'm very happy to be part of this very prominent panel of scientists. And I warmly thanks all the organizers and especially Federico Olic and Martin Bosic that are also strictly friend of Italian University and of Cagliari, and also personal friends. So what I want to introduce here is quantum information meets machine learning. So basically, I like to introduce generally this topic by starting from a provocative question. I ask you, can you show me a picture of your Christmas 2018? I am sure that you can, and I am sure that if you try to find a picture of your Christmas, for instance, in your mobile, you will find it, but probably you need time to find it, just because now we use to make a lot of pics with our mobile, because the memory that our mobile has now is very, very huge, and many, many pics can be stored in a cellular, for instance, in a mobile. So what we can say is that can we say that many data corresponds to many information? Basically not, because the information means recover from the data what we really need. So the fact that now we have to deal with a very, very huge amount of information means that potentially we can have a lot of information. But the problem is the process we need to do in order to extrapolate this information from this big amount of data. So this is the reason why in the last decades, big data science is supposed to face with just this kind of processes, this kind of problem. And so the problem is how to manage huge amount of data in order to retrieve in the shorter time as possible the information we need. Okay, so this is why big data both in the last decade. And this is just a very brief summary of what I said in these 5 minutes. So in other words, enlarging the dimension of the data set is a good thing because increases the potential information, but is also bad because makes the extraction of the required information harder. So from another side, you know very well how quantum information born, how quantum information became in the recent past a really new discipline of quantum theory in general, quantum computing mostly. And we know that the advantage of quantum computation are most of the advantages are most of all based on the fact that we have a speed up of the computation. We can perform a computer, a strong and hard computation in a very, very shorter time with respect to a classical one. Okay, so we know also that quantum computation is not so futuristic. We can say that till 10, maybe 20 years ago, we were speaking about quantum computation as something that was fantascientific, that was not really concrete. But we know that the application in quantum computation has very, very speed up in the last decade. And now we know that the quantum processor already exists. And we know that also by using, for instance, our our computer in our house, we can connect with the IBM quantum experience and we can just design a quantum algorithm, and by a click we can send this quantum algorithm to a real quantum computer that will perform it, that will give us back the result as a statistical result. So basically the quantum computation is now real, And also we know that this, this topic is going on and on. And for instance, just 1 year ago, in China, that was was declared the achievement of quantum supremacy, because it was possible to perform a calculation in 200 seconds, a kind of calculation that would take more than half a billion years on the world's faster non-quantum or classical computer. So now we really trust in quantum computation. We really trust in this. So we were speaking about big data and about quantum computation. But because, well, summarizing, the main problem of big data, machine learning with big data, is the time complexity of the computation. But the main advantage of quantum computation is the possibility to reproduce, to reduce the time complexity. So in a certain sense, quantum computation and machine learning appears as a very natural and maybe unavoidable connection. But the connection can be deeper and deeper with respect to what we can think. Indeed, the question that I want to ask you in this talk is, can quantum information theory help classical machine learning, classical, by using classical computer only? And we will provide a positive answer to this question. So this approach that we will speak is known as a quantum-inspired machine learning. And the important thing is that, well, very often when we know that in many disciplines, we speak about inspiration from quantum mechanics. Okay, now what I want to focus on is the fact that our inspiration is not just an analogy, is not a metaphor, but it's just a really inspiration regarding really inspiration to quantum world in order to have a real benefit in machine learning. And in the next minutes, I aim to show you what I mean by real inspiration. Okay, in particular, we focus on the classification problem. What is the classification problem? Okay, the general idea is that the quantum classification, the idea that we want to perform is the idea of a quantum classifier, where quantum classification is, the idea of quantum classification is to formalize the standard classification problems in terms of a mathematical quantum object. And then, inspired by certain properties of quantum state discrimination, we define a quantum classifier that will provide interesting and real good advantages. The procedure is based on three fundamental steps that we will describe not now, but few slides later: encoding, classification, and decoding. But we will meet this slide again in a bit. First of all, I want to very, very quickly summarize what is the, the general framework of classification problem. So when we have to classify an object, we describe this object as a vector where each component of this vector is a feature of this object, this object could be a cat, and this feature could be the length of the tail, the weight of the cat, and so on. And we have different classes of object, for instance, dog and cats, so a pattern is represented by a pair, where this is the vector, the object represented by a vector. And this is the label that characterizes the class. For instance, label one means class of the cat. Label two means class of the dogs, for instance, okay? And the goal of the classification is to have a classifier, a function. A classifier is a function that allows us to study the vector and gives as an output the label. So looking at the vector, looking at the object, I can say you if this object is a cat or is a dog, basically. Okay. So in a general supervised scenario, I will be very, 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 I will skip many slides, but sometimes I can focus on some technical data, sometimes not. Generally, in when we say supervised learning, we mean that we consider a data set, for instance, a data set of dogs and a data set of cats, for instance, and we divide this data set at the beginning in two parts. The first part is given by the training set. This is the set useful in order to train our algorithm. And this is the test set. The test set is a set of objects that we use in order to know whether our algorithm is good or not, just in order to measure the performance of our algorithm. And so, obviously, then all of these objects are already labeled. So we already know the label of the object. So the goal is just to evaluate if the classifier is good or not. So we use an already labeled set of objects. We divide it in training and test. And obviously also the training is divided with respect to the classes. So the classes of cat, the classes of dog, the classes of foxes, and so on. Okay, so the first idea of the quantum classification is just to formally translate each cat that is represented by a vector in terms of a quantum object that we represent by a density operator rho. And there are many, many ways to encode. This is just the encoding, to encode a real vector in terms of a quantum object. Okay, in terms of a density operator. Obviously, it is only a formal translation. We are not transforming a cat in a photon or a dog in an electron, obviously, okay? So now, once we have translated all the data set of real data in terms of the data set of quantum data, again, we can consider the distinction between training and test again. And the idea is just to obtain a quantum classifier that is a function that has as input a quantum object of the quantum test set and as the output the label. So given this quantum object, that is the density operator that represents an unknown object, we can obtain by the classifier that this object is a dog. Okay, so obviously what we have to show is that this translation from classical to quantum object has some benefit, provides some benefit, otherwise it's totally useless, okay? So, okay. Now let us talk regarding the general setting in quantum state discrimination. Okay, that probably most of you already know, but I very briefly summarize here. Let R be a set of density operator, and suppose that Alice wishes to communicate an information to Bob by using a quantum system that is one of the systems belonging to this state. Okay, to this aim, Alice prepares a quantum system in one of these states, and hands the system over to Bob. In principle, Bob has a complete knowledge about R. So Bob already knows which are row 1, row 2, row m, but he does not know the actual state of the system that he have received by Alice. So in order to, so that the Bob's task is to determine which one is among this state in one shot, just by making a single von Neumann measurement over all possible, sorry, all possible physical observable. So the, and so the possibility is that the measure, the outcome of the measurement could be just the raw that Alice sent to Bob, or not, or can be another one. In the first case, okay, we say that Bob succeed. In another case, we say that Bob fails. Okay, so what is the probability for Bob to succeed? Okay, given a set R of quantum state and a von Neumann measurement M, the average probability to Bob, for Bob to perform a correct discrimination, so to correct individuate which is the state that was sent from Alice, is given by this quantity, is given by this quantity. And the aim, of course, is the maximize this probability. So to minimize the probability to have an error, okay? So the question is, what is the measure that maximize the probability to have a correct discrimination? And this measure was obtained by Elstrom, by this strategy. Okay, the strategy is related only to the binary case. So consider to have just row one and row two. And if we consider this quantity, P1 row one minus P2 row two, where P1 and P2 are a priori probability, okay, that can be obtained in some different but empirical way, for instance, we obtain this quantity. We calculate the positive and negative eigenvalues of this quantity. We consider the respective eigenvectors, and we consider the sum of the projector built over all of each of these eigenvectors. In this way, we can obtain P plus and P minus, and Hellstrom showed that this P plus and P minus is a von Neumann measurement that is optimal, that is the optimal measure for the discrimination problem, for the binary discrimination problem that we have introduced at the moment. So this is the bound. And intuitively, P plus and P minus represent the property for the system to be correctly identified as being the state row one or row two, respectively. Okay, and the Elstrom bound can be seen as a measurement of distinguishability between row one and row two. So now, again, with this slide, because now we have all the ingredients we need in order to put together classification problem and quantum state discrimination. The first stage is the encoding. We said that we need to have real object and translate the real vector and translate them in terms of quantum object, like a density operators, like a pure states. And for instance, it is easy to see because there are several ways to do this. This is one simple way, for instance, by using the stereographic projection, we map each object, in this simple case, two feature object, in a point over a sphere and over a surface, one sphere, and that's correspond to the point of the block sphere. So a pure density matrix, a pure state. But there are many other possibilities to encode real object in terms of density matrix, pure density matrix. Okay, so once we do that, once we have set of quantum states, set of density operators, for each training set, we represent each class by a quantum centroid that is defined in this way. This is just the beginning of our algorithm. And it is no longer a pure state, of course, because it is just the sum of all the state of all the encoded vector belonging to a given class. Okay, obviously the quantum centroid are mixed states, and they are not the encoding of the respective classical centroid. They are a totally new object that has not any counterpart in the real world, in the world of real object, in the world of real vectors, okay? Okay, so now we use quantum state discrimination. We use the Elvstrom measurement that is optimal. So we use P plus and P minus that we built by considering as the two states to discriminate, we will consider the two centroids. So let us consider a case where we want to discriminate between cats and dogs. We consider the training set of the cats. We encoding this set in terms of quantum object. We consider the centroid of this class. We do the same for the dogs. And we have these two quantum centroids define an R2-density operator. And from these two quantum centroids, we can apply the Elvstrom discrimination, and we can obtain the Elvstrom measurement, the optimal Elvstrom measurement, P plus and P minus. Okay? So once we pick another quantum object from the test set, we have to say, this quantum object, is a set or is a dog? In order to determine this, we consider this classifier that is called the Elvstrom quantum classifier. We consider these two values. If the trace of P plus times rho is greater than P minus times rho, we say that in a certain sense, rho x is closer to the centroid of the cat. Otherwise, rho x is closer to the centroid of the dog. And so we can make a proper classification. Okay, why we use quantum state discrimination? What is the intuition that is above this idea? The application of quantum state discrimination for classification is inspired by the idea that better is the discrimination between two centroids, and better I can distinguish between two classes. And so more performant is the classifier. In other words, greater is the Elvstrom bound that, remind me, I said it is, that can be considered as a measurement of distinguishability between two centroids, and greater will be, for instance, the accuracy of the classifier, where the accuracy means just the number of time that the classification was correct over the total number of experiments. Okay. This idea is not only an intuitive idea, but that was just exploited, that was just proved by an experiment. So we have provided an experiment where this classifier has been applied to 14 different data sets and compared with 11 different and generally well-performing standard classifier. For instance, what we can see is that generally, once the Elvstrom bound increases, the Elvstrom bound increases together with the increasing of the balanced accuracy. So this idea seems to be correct, that increasing the measurement of distinguishability between two centroids, it is together with the increasing of the accuracy of the classifier. So this intuition is corroborated by the experience. And okay, we have many data. When we compared this classifier, this Elstrom classifier with many standard classifier, and we show that our classifier is generally better, not always, but okay, the average performance of the quantum-inspired classifier, the Elstrom classifier, is very, very high with respect to the other standard classical classifier. Okay, now I have many data to show, but okay, this is just a comparison. In this data, in these tables, you can realize I don't say supremacy, but something like this of our Elstrom classifier with respect to the other. But that's not all. Indeed, a sharp difference between classical and quantum information theory is also based on the fact that sometimes considering a tensor copy of an object can provide a benefit in our computation, can provide, let's say, a kind of additional information with respect to the original information that is given by the initial single state. So what we do is just repeat exactly the same algorithm that I have described you above before, but after the encoding, instead of the density operator rho that I obtained from the encoding, by the encoding from the initial object, instead of this rho, I consider rho times itself n times. I calculate a new centroid and I define again a new classifier in a new Elstrom observable in the new dimensionals, in a new k dimensional space, in a new larger space. And again, I define a new Elstrom quantum classifier, let's say k tensor product Elstrom quantum classifier. What we see is that by increasing the number of the copy, also the Elstrom bound increases. And so we see that the accuracy that we obtain after making this copy in a computational way, just by making it by Mathematica, okay, or by Python, this copy. But what we see is that by making this procedure, we have benefit because we increase the accuracy of the process. We increase again the accuracy of the process. Okay, and again, we have data to show, okay, we have something, but okay, I want to use just the last 5 minutes talk maybe to show you a practical experiment that was provided together with the University of Cambridge and the Institute of Molecular Bioimaging of the University of Catania. And the topic is a clonogenic assay. The clonogenic assay is a quantification technique of the survival degree of an in vitro cell cultures, which is based on the ability of a single cell to grow and form a colony of cells. This colony is not a good thing. That is a symbol of something, something grave disease. The purpose is to count the number of the colonies. So the picture that we have to deal are picture like this, where this is a colony, this is a colony, this is a colony, and so on. Okay. Recent results show how by a classification between pixel X belongs to the colony, or pixel X belongs to the background, by making this classification, it is possible to have information about the number of the colonies. There is a correlation between this. This is a biological result in a quantum in imaging and biology fields that have this result. But it is an assist for us because it allows us to move the clonogenic assay in a binary classification context. So for each pixel, if we are able to classify if this pixel is in the colony or it is in the background, we can have some result regarding the number of the copy that is in the clonogenic assay. And so,
Giuseppe,
yeah,
you have 10 minutes, including the posting.
Okay, so just I thank you. I just spend a few minutes to conclude, and I leave a few minutes also for questions. Okay. Okay, so the experiment involved many data, about 10 million of data, and the result that we had was against that the performance of our Elstrom classifier with respect to other, in this case, 18 well-performant classifier, is very good, because our classifier in most of the cases was one of the best with respect to the other. And that was very, very nice for us. So let me conclude with some open problem. Okay, the first open problem is this. The generalization of this quantum inspired. And now we know why I say quantum inspired. And now we know why I really say that this inspiration is usual. It's not only a matter of metaphor. But this quantum inspiration was based on only a binary quantum state discrimination. So the challenge is to have a multi-class classifier. And the second goal should be just to use this quantum inspired algorithm also in a quantum computer, just in order to come from quantum inspired to quantum. So we have some partial result regarding both of this point. Basically, regarding the idea of multi-class classifier, we are working on this, but we are taking inspiration from the pretty good measurement that is not an optimal, but a sub-optimal measurement that allows us to have a quantum multi-classifier. And on the other hand, well, I have not time to show you the detail of the pretty good classifier, but the idea is the same, but instead of to have an optimal, we have a suboptimal measurement, but also this suboptimal measurement can be used for n-ary classification instead of only binary classification. And also the final challenge, as I said, is just to come from quantum inspired to really quantum machine learning in order to put together the double benefit of quantum. So increase the accuracy, but also speed up the computation. Well, by appealing to the Neumark deletion theorem, is it possible in principle to reproduce NPOVM measurement? And for instance, also the Hellstrom of the pretty good measurement. This is an example, but we are working on this. Until now, we have only partial result regarding this, but the works are still in progress. And okay, this is the bibliography, the reference that you can refer to. And okay, thank you all for listening. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Giuseppe, for your interesting talk. Now we have some minutes to questions and comments. If you want to make a question, please indicate it in the chat. I have a little question for you, Giuseppe. Do you know if there is a mathematical relation between the Hellstrom bound and the accuracy of your classifier?
Okay, so yes, are you asking if there is a connection between Hellstrom bound and accuracy? Right, okay, well, basically not, because it's very strange, because there are really two topics that are that was never merged together between before now, because in a certain sense Hellstrom was not thinking about the classification problem. So, in a certain sense, Hellstrom, well, quantum state discrimination has not the idea of what is the accuracy, because the accuracy could be calculated empirically only by making the experiment. Theoretically we have is this result. Is this result that is interesting regarding the Hellstrom bound, and it is easy to mislead because we are not saying that we are not saying this Hellstrom bound between two states is less of the Hellstrom bound between the states that you obtain by making the tensor copy of itself by itself, because in this case it is an already well-known result. Here we are saying this something different, because these objects are quantum centroid. This tensor K rho is not rho times rho times rho K times. It is something different. It's the centroid that we obtain by making, in principle, K copies of each object of the dataset, and after making the centroid. So in a certain sense, this is a first, let me say that, theoretical result that put together quantum state discrimination and classification problem, because there is the idea of centroid and there is the idea of Hellstrom bound putting together. I hope to answer to your question.
Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Another question or comment? If not, thank you again, Giuseppe, for your talk.
Thank you all.
We will pass to the next talk. It's in charge of Jorge. Jorge Hirsch with the talk Probability and Quantum Physics. Jorge, are you there?
Yes, I am here. Can you see me?
Yes, we can see you. You need to share your presentation.
Okay, so I will start sharing my screen. So can you see my screen?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. So we are perfectly in time. And thank you very much for this nice invitation. I had the pleasure to be 2 years ago in Cordoba in the 8th version of this gathering. And it was really, really very productive. And I must say I miss the presence to be there, all the sharings. But okay, this is what we have now, and we don't know for how long we will be in this situation, so let's enjoy what we have. So I'm moving to a different topic from my previous colleague, and this is essentially going to the relationship, with some relationship between probability and quantum physics, and it's essentially related with the consequences of the violation of Bell inequalities. And this is a work which has been done along the PhD thesis of Aldo Solis. He is now at the very end of his PhD studies, and also in collaboration with Melina Gastelum. Melina is a very, very interesting and very smart person, and she studied physics, and then she had a PhD in philosophy of science, and now she is professor at UNAM and at the philosophy faculty. And so this led essentially most of the results I will show today. I reported in this kind of recent article, which was published in this special issue of Entropy about quantum probability and randomness. So Okay, let me tell you how it starts for me here. So it started for me in this way. I have been working for many years in what is called a many-body low-energy quantum physics, in nuclear physics, in quantum optics. So for many, many years, quantum physics for me meant the Schrödinger equation and most of the time the stationary version of the Schrödinger equation. But obviously I was aware that there are this relativistic extension, at least in the non-interacting case, you can generalize and make it compatible with this special relativity. And I am far from being expert on these areas, but I know that I have very, very good friends which have worked in quantum field theory and in a way to extend or to use, to introduce the fundamental interaction in field theory and even the space-time I'm trying to. This is taken from this space where it is mentioned, the theory of everything, which I find is a very funny way to try to do physics. But anyway, in all these, there is a common line which is kind of growing what today's the areas which, or the kind of systems which are trying to be described, but all have dynamics and time in them. But then, you are familiar, we have many talks here, when quantum information enters. And for me, it was kind of a shock, because even the way these things are written, are expressed, are completely different from all these things here. These are differential equations, and there is time here, and there are interactions or forces or fields. And here we have nearly none of them. We have initial states, we have gates, and which act over 1 qubit, over 2 qubits, and we have final states. And there is no time here, there are only steps by steps by steps in which each step is done. And so it has been very, very interesting to ask myself, okay, but then what have all they in common? What is this? Why? Because all this has in common, in some sense, in quantum physics, but what is similar with all of them? And I agree with a great part of the community that this is my view in this moment, that the most relevant quantum result is the Born rule, which, you know, associate the given state, what are the different probabilities to get a given result at any time or at any step when you perform a measurement. And so this was in my evolution a real change in how I see what is quantum physics talking about. And this is what I have written in the abstract of my presentation, because I think, and perhaps this is a very old way of seeing it, but for me it was kind of making contact with that, is that essentially all the quantum physics machinery is about is to give the probability of obtaining some results after some manipulations, which can be done intentionally or can be driven by interactions. And essentially that's it. And you know, it is not a new idea. There are many people who see quantum physics in that way. And at the same time, it is clear that this is different from the way at least we used in the university to teach quantum physics or to express what is relevant here. Because we used to try to make contact with classical physics to describe how is the system at any time, what is the dynamics of the system, and including probabilities, it is kind of very different. And even now, for example, in the Bachelor Studies in Physics at my university at UNAM in Mexico, there is no teaching at all of probabilities. There is some statistics used at a very, very simple level to manipulate the experiment, the experimental result, to present some average standard deviations, slightly more than that, but no mention of probabilities at all. So this is a very peculiar situation, because on one hand, we have this very incredibly powerful formalism, which is quantum physics, which has been so useful, so productive in the last century, and has generated so many technologies. And these technologies have completely changed our life and even allow this kind of communication we are having in this moment. And at the same time, is talking about these object probabilities, which are kind of strange for us. At least we have in the same faculty, science faculty, where physics is taught, we have actuaries, and these guys, they work with the probabilities all the time. They work for insurance company, they work for banks, and so they are used to employ probabilities, at least to use probability in different ways. But then if quantum physics is about probability, the interpretation of what is quantum physics telling us about the world is intimately related, depends on what is probability. And the most important, I can tell you the bottom line of my talk also, is that there are many, many interpretations of what the probability is, many, many different, and it depends of what kind of probability you decide to employ. And we are using probabilities all the time, but we are using it in many, many different ways. All the time, and we sometimes ask for a probability of something, and really we are answering with a different kind of probability, and you are familiar with that completely. We I think this is deeply connected with a very, very well known fact, which sometimes is difficult to accept, which we do not know the future, and we cannot control the future. And I think it has to do with the science, which we sometimes are doing, because science in many cases is interpreted or used to pretend that with science we can really control what will happen. And we have incredibly many resources, and science is helping to do many things. But at the end, we have no control, and we can see that COVID is one very, very obvious example. The disaster we are doing with our planet is another example. We can do many things, but we cannot control the output, the final output. We can control sometimes in a very short time. So the best things we can do is use probabilities. This is challenging because when we say what are probabilities, it is a different, a very, very different interpretation. We are used to say, okay, do I need really to carry an umbrella for this afternoon? So what are the probabilities that this afternoon will rain? And this is different. What are the probabilities that the December the 1st in La Plata will rain? Because there you have a list of many, many December 1st of the previous years, and you can take the average, the distribution of days in which were rainy or not, and look, combine this with the present information from satellites, and this makes you, this gives you, but you see this is a different thing, and what will happen today, because today is a unique event. So for the people who are, oh, this is not what I wanted to do. For the people who are making statistics, for people working in climatology, just today, just another number to add to a very long list. But for us, today is the only day we have. And these are different probabilities. And this is closely related with quantum physics, because we can think, okay, but then quantum physics is talking about an ensemble of situation, or this giving information about one individual output of this particular system. And this is just part. And I like this, this really, really excellent report by Holm and Whitaker. And there they say also, for example, they cite these authors which conjecture, so the only real difference between the different views expressed on quantum interpretation ultimately boils down to a difference in the interpretation of probability. And Jammer suggests that the different interpretation of probability in the quantum mechanics may even be taken as a kind of criterion for the classification of the various interpretation of quantum mechanics, which I think this is useful, but it is not enough. But we are all changing from one interpretation to the other in our daily life and in our work all the time, because in probability is something we need to use all the time, and at the same time we use them in different ways. So okay, making more direct contact with quantum physics. So we have this incredibly useful, powerful formalism to predict probabilities about microscopic systems. And a question which has been with us, with the quantum physics from the time it was built, is, are there other variables beyond quantum mechanics which determine the quantum probabilities? And if they are, or they could be there, what kind of hidden variables they can be? And these questions, you know, you are familiar with that, Bell really produced a very interesting way to answer that far beyond quantum theories. Because one thing which is very, very interesting about Bell inequalities is they are not at all related directly with quantum physics. It is obvious that the Bell inequalities give some ways to connect with experiments, and they are violated in experiments, and this experiment can be described perfectly with quantum physics. So the kind of experiments in which Bell inequalities are observed are well described by quantum physics, but it It is one aspect, but Bell inequalities do not imply at all, do not use quantum physics in it, in the formulation. So this is essentially what I will repeat for you. I will tell perhaps things which are very familiar to you. So the violation of Bell inequalities, and we will come to it again in the next slides, has been interpreted by many authors as showing that if hidden variables exist at all, they must be contextual. And contextuality has been at the core, and obviously it offers many of the resources which have given this strong expectation about quantum computation and the security of the quantum internet. And also this contextuality, if special relativity is valid, leads in some scenarios also to non-locality. So if we accept this, that hidden variables could exist, some ways to interpret, to read the violation of inequalities has convinced many people in our community that these hidden variables must be contextual and non-local. And also, they are employed in the quantum technology now, because in quantum information, violation of Bell inequalities is a way to identify the quantum length of states. And it in the quantum random number generators, the intrinsic randomness of these quantum number generators is assumed to be shown to be valid because they violate the Bell inequalities. So it is a very important tool in two different directions, in the direction of the foundation of quantum physics and at the very basis of the security of quantum communications and as a certification of the quantumness of a state. And so there are two parts. One part is what kind of probability are we talking about? And but in this what I will be talking about is essentially about what can we conclude using a very kind of neutral way to talk about probabilities, which to employ Kolmogorov axioms. Because in general, Kolmogorov axioms define formally what huge part of the classical probabilities, what is a classical probability, and it is completely mute about interpretations. So can we use simply this way without to entering the part of interpretation of probability, which is huge and very interesting, and just use the formal part? Okay, so this is what we do now. So Kolmogorov axioms refer to probability space. And this probability space has essentially three elements. The first one is the sample space, which are all the possible results which one wants to describe. Which obviously all these parts have a very, very subtle things. In the case of the dice, there are one dice, two dice, or whatever, are very simple, but there are many, many cases that even you can discuss, it is possible to list the possible outcomes or to describe them or not. So there are many different situations. But okay, let's assume that there is a sample space. Then we have the event space, which are subset of the sample space. It can be all the subsets or some of them, depending the situation. We don't, and there are some extra rules about what an event space must be. The null space must be there. The whole sample space, but the whole universe of results must be there. And if one subset is there, the complement subset must be there. But okay, we have this event space, and then we postulate that there is a probability measure. And this is the part which is familiar to all of us, to all of us. Yes, this probability measure must be positive and between 0 and 1, and the probability that any of the events can occur is 1, which means essentially that this sample space lists all the possible results we are looking at. And obviously we have this rule: if two events are disjoint, they cannot occur at the same time, then the probability of these events is just the sum of the respective the individual probabilities. Here it is a mistake here. This is the union, not the intersection, sorry. So this is the probability that any of them, E1 and E2, can, this is, okay, yes, this is the probability, and this equal thing should not be there. This is the probability of the intersection I define here, and this is the probability of the union of both of them. Sorry, this is a mistake. This equal sign should not be here. And also we have these conditional probabilities, which also means that if they are independent, then you recover if the event one and event one does not depend of event two, then this you recover just the probability of event one, if there are the product of them. And okay, let's move to a simple version of the Bell experiment. And in this case, we have four quantities. I like to describe it in terms of photons. And here, so we select two different polarization bases. And each polarization basis, we can have a couple of results. We use for notation 0 and 45 degrees for the basis, but obviously in the for to have the violation of the Bell inequalities, we need to have other ones also, but this is just for notation. So we have two possible polarization bases, and each polarization basis we have two results that we prefer to label as 0 and 1. And we have two different kind of sample spaces. One of them is in which each event lists, for example, the angle selected in the left hand side, the angle selected in the right hand side, and the possible output for each side, and the possible hidden variables, anything else which could be controlling or could be, defining the output. And this is one way to formulate the sample space, but there is also other very often used sample space where it is assumed that the outputs are for any, they are independent of what we are measuring, both angles have results. So I can have the result in this case. I can have the result for 0 and 45 degrees at the same time. These are possible, these are hidden variables in this sense, additional to other possible hidden variables. And here, for example, I have the list. If I select on the left-hand side the angle, the polarization basis, the angle 0, and the result was 1, then I have this condition, but I can have all the other conditions, and this is the marginal probability of having this event. And this is given by this probability. This is one possible event that when the left-hand side, we selected the basis at zero angle and the output was 1, and independent of what happened on the other side or for the other variables. And what is, well, it is a technical detail, but it is important that for this side, these are not the individual events that this happened here, that when we select the angle, but these are the conditional probabilities. And this is important. So here I give an example of this sample space 1. And this is sample space 2, and you see here what I was mentioned in the sample space 2, it is assumed that the two outputs have values, but only one of them was observed. And so in this case, for example, it is assumed that, for example, we selected the basis at 0 degrees and got the output 0, for example, in this case, here we have 0, but it is assumed that all the other values for the other angle on the same side existed but were not measured. So these are these, for example, if this is measured, this is a hidden variable besides all these other variables. And this what we have in this probability space 2 is essentially equivalent to the conditional probability in the space 1. And this is an example. Here we see in space 1 we have different possibilities, and we have selected, for example, one angle, and these are the different outputs. And in the space 2 we assume that both angles have values, but only this one were observed. So these results, which are in circle, coincide with this one, but there were other values. And we see here how this probability coincides with the conditional probability in the space 1. And Bell inequalities, I'm sure you are familiar with this way to write the Bell inequalities when these variables take the value minus 1 or 1. But we prefer to use the values 0, 1. And when you change from 1, minus 1, 1 to 0, 1, the Bell inequalities read in this way. It's slightly more complex because you have these other two terms. Why did we do that? Because when you have only values 0 and 1, the expectation value of A is exactly the same as the probability that A is 1. So we can go from expectation values to probabilities. And this is what we wanted to do explicitly here. So in space 1, for example, the average value of A in the left-hand side and B in the right-hand side is exactly the probability of having the values 1 in A and B given alpha and beta, and the angles of the polarization basis. And in space 2, This is the probability as this event. Again, you see here the conditional probabilities, and this is the probability of this event. So in space one, we have, and these are the way we write these probabilities. Then this is the most common version of the Bell inequalities. You have this integration here and this probability depending of all these variables, and you are doing the integration of these hidden variables. But then are two well-known hypotheses, the locality hypothesis, which assume that the left-hand side and the right-hand side are independent, they are, cannot influence each other, and the lambda independence, which assume that these hidden variables does not depend on the polarization angle selected. So if we do this, then we obtain this inequality. And this is space one inequality. On the other hand, doing the in space two, we have simply this interpretation, this reading, which is just even more direct. And now we, given that we have this product of results of some kind of result, we need to integrate not only or to zoom not only over these hidden variables, but also over the non-observed variables which are assumed to exist. Here, if we have alpha and beta, we integrate over alpha prime, beta prime, and we arrive with this different form here. And this is essentially the main result, and I think this is more or less my time. So in inequality one, we not only assume that there is a sample space and an event space and the Kolmogorov axioms are valid, but also we assume locality and lambda independence. While in the sample space two, assuming that both values exist all the time, it is only Kolmogorov axioms what is used. And you can see here, so as all the experiments show that the Bell inequalities are violated in experiments, many people in the foundation of physics community likes to use the inequality one and conclude that as locality is violated or it is closely related with contextuality or lambda independence. So the usual conclusion is that these hypotheses are violated. But many people, for example, in the quantum information area likes this version because it is, if Kolmogorov axioms are valid, then you can say, okay, then these values do not exist before the measurement. They are not really there. So this is the kind of expression, the kind of result which the people in the quantum information community likes to use, saying, oh, connecting with this, there are no values before measurements. So they are completely secure, completely unknown, completely random. So these are, and then, so we could go far beyond that, because the inequality one is used usually to show that if there are hidden variables, they must be non-local or contextual. But we could say that the sample space doesn't exist. But this is interesting because the Broglie-Bloom formalisms is an example of hidden variables of which then violate this hypothesis. Or also, we could assume that Kolmogorov axioms are not valid. And this is very interesting because when you formulate quantum mechanics in phase space, using the Wigner quasi-probability distribution, then we can assign probabilities simultaneously for position and momentum, but probabilities are negative in some cases. So you see, for example, that in the phase space formalism of quantum mechanics, what is violated is one of the Kolmogorov axioms.
Jorge, you have 5 minutes.
Okay, so I will just summarize.
Okay.
So in the other case, obviously the most common way is to assume that the sample space does not exist. But we could also assume different things. So the possible interpretations are far wider than the most commonly assumed. And even we can say, okay, forget about probabilities and just take the average of the different results for the different angles. And we can show that, again, this inequality is valid as is violated. And this is also very, very popular for friends in the quantum information community. And here, that what is assumed is the four variable high defined values in all the runs, while only two of them are measures. And then, so the if you go, for example, for the frequentist point of view, you would say that this each of these sums belongs to different collectives, and they cannot be combined in one expression, that this is not valid. So it is kind of assuming like some version of the first sampling that even if you are measuring different things at different in different realization of the experiment, they are it is valid to combine them. If this is true, then the violation will show that these numbers cannot exist. Okay. But just to finish, we can say, okay, but this is about Bell inequalities, but we know that the Cohen-Specker theorem proves contextuality if quantum physics is valid. So quantum, this needs, it is not as strong as Bell inequalities because it requires quantum physics. And this is the well-known Peres-Mermin square. And here the main point is that you have three different spins, and you take the products, and the products of the operators have this minus one here. But if you will have numbers here, you cannot produce this minus one here different from the plus one in any way to assign values. So you can say, okay, it doesn't matter about the evaluation of Bell inequalities, contextuality. If quantum mechanics is valid, then the Cohen-Specker theorems prove that physics must be contextual. But, oh, here, it has been shown more than 20 years ago that this requires infinite precision in the measurements. And if you have finite precision, this is not true. If you not can set exactly the angles for the polarization, then this is not true. But then, soon after that, Adán Cabello showed that the Cohen-Specker contextuality can be recoded, but using probabilities. Then we return to, again, the interpretation of the Cohen-Specker theorem requires the use of probabilities. So the results are depends. So the interpretation of the violation of Bell inequalities and even the Cohen-Specker theorem depends on different probability theories and different colleagues with different, if they like the realism or they are more in the ensemble interpretation, they will have different views. So this is essentially my conclusion. I hope you know this Magritte drawing. And I think in my personal view, as this is not really a pipe, This is just a representation of a pipe, and this is far from the real thing. So I think quantum physics is also like this drawing. It has a very good feeling of what it is, but it is that the real thing is what we have in our general experience, and is far more richer than anything we can do with our theory. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Jorge, for your talk. Now we are on time, but we can take some minutes for a question or a comment. Fundamentals quantica. Falik.
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, thanks. Thanks, Jorge, for this wonderful talk. I wanted to ask you just to see if I understand the message when you analyze the Bell inequalities. Suppose that you assume that unperformed measurements have no values, or even that Kolmogorov actions are not valid, like, for example, that you have negative probabilities, right? So suppose that you are in that direction. What would you say about non-locality? Would you still say that under those assumptions, it follows that quantum mechanics gives place to some non-local phenomena or something like that?
Well, Pitofsky have developed at some moment a particular example of very strange hidden variables which could be non-local. But then there are a lot of other rules. It is a very, very artificial and non-useful model that just was kind of to demonstrate that very strange things could happen. We don't know. So I would say that there are correlation between the output of the experiment, which are non-local. So, and this is a kind of very conservative affirmation. See, I am with a group of people who has this view that we don't know what happens between preparation and measurement. And we would like to know, and we have spent 90 years trying to figure out what happens. But, so in fact, I have no idea.
Okay, I see. Because for me, my impression is that you have an explicit form of non-locality when you assume that you have some hidden variables and a global classical probability distribution. And then it's quite clear because of Bell, right? It's clear that you have a non-local action. But if you take that off, I mean, those assumptions, if you drop them, it is not clear what kind of non-locality are you talking about. You see what I mean?
I think, for example, it is very, very nicely described when you have this delay choice experiment, when you have registered all the output of your measurement of Bell states, and then you post select some subsets. And depending what kind of subsets you select, you will see or you will not see any correlations. So, yes, there are very interesting things going on there, and they are useful because they're not only useful, they are the way the quantum internet is being built, because as they cannot be repeaters, quantum repeaters, because we have not, it is impossible to copy and perfectly an unknown quantum states, then you use teleportation, which is very close to that. So these kind of phenomena are taking place there, and they are useful. What happened, for example, in teleportation, I really like what the way the cubism described teleportation, which is your belief about one system have now change from being about one system to being about other system, but the only thing we change is your belief. You are looking in this direction and you are looking in that direction. It's the only thing which, so this is, and somehow I like this. I know that many colleagues would prefer to have something more solid and more independent of the observer, and but I like this version of science where we as human beings are the ones which assume things and believe things. And obviously I am convinced that I'm not the only thing, or we are not the only, there is a very rich universe of interactions, but we only interaction with this universe about through our beliefs, not only through our senses, but the senses plus the belief, plus the common conviction. We are trained at the university to see things in one way. And after that, it is very difficult to see things in a different way because the training is very good.
Yes, 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 thanks. Thanks, Jorge, thanks.
Okay.
I agree.
Thank you, Jorge, for the talk, and Federico for the questions and comments. Now we will have a break.
One question, because the time difference, I couldn't see some talks. There are they recorded? Can we see later in the YouTube channel?
Yes, you can see the talks in the YouTube channel, and also we will put the talks in the website of the conference. But this last thing will happen in some days.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation. It is a pleasure to be here.
It's a pleasure to have you talk in this conference. Okay, we will be back at 2 o'clock.
Perfect.
Remember that